an emotional side is, this is a porn star. I'm like, well, what the fuck just happened?
You're seeing that thing like 40 times. Mm-hmm. You kind of, I imagine, to some degree, become emotionally numb to the way that that feels.
Fun fact, I edited this whole video in an afternoon.
What does a training manual for an editor look like?
I didn't want to call him out, but yes.
I'd have never noticed that.
You don't, but you feel it. Negotiations are really tense, especially ones handling this type of money.
What are the questions that someone should be asking themselves, or the checkboxes that they should be acknowledging?
And then every time I see that, I always ask the question, why? There is some kid this second playing with some AI tool that's giving them the opportunity and starting them on that same life path that's gonna make me obsolete in 5 years. Cheers.
Hayden.
Mm. Hello there.
The first guest on the Zack Honarvar podcast. Guess what it's called?
The Zack Honarvar podcast?
Yeah.
Wow. No, is that what it's called?
No.
Oh, what is it called?
Called Risky Business.
Ooh.
What do you think of the name?
I like that. Is it like a pun to it, or is it just like straight up risky?
Well, I think it's just because a lot of creators and creative entrepreneurs are in a very risky field.
Mm.
And I think like that's like a whole new wave of risky endeavors to be in.
Well, I think this made me realize actually that the whole industry we are in, it is completely based on risk, because since it is such a young industry, the rule book hasn't been written yet. We're writing the rule book, so we don't know what it is. And so part of us has to be making the mistakes. Someone has to be making the wins to us, to tell everyone else, hey, here is the rules, I would say. And so that does make sense. And I think, and everything I've been doing definitely past year or so, or past 2-3 years, has just been straight up risk, having no idea what the outcome's going to be. So actually, yeah, this does make sense. It's an excellent name.
I love it. And a very fitting first episode, given that you've been such a core member of the Creator Now community for a very long time. But where I want to start today, Hayden, is all the way back in Reading, Royal Berkshire, England.
Reading. Yeah, it's called Reading, Royal Berkshire.
Royal Berkshire.
Yes.
What is that town like?
It's a town right outside London, so it's a decent connection to London, and I think it was just the perfect encapsulation of just a normal town.
Hmm.
Like, it wasn't incredible, it wasn't bad, it was just perfectly suburban with a really decent town centre that had a decent connection to London. I think genuinely, I would say probably one of the best towns you could possibly grow up in England. Because, yeah, direct connection to London, and then you can still have a bit of town life.
Interesting. And did you grow up in a big family? Is all your family from there?
Yeah, I think my whole family's from there. So I think I've got 2 brothers, dad. I've also got my stepmother, Sharon, as well. But I think she came in later on in life. But, yeah, I think I just mostly lived with my dad and my 2 brothers. And then I think also just like shard of glass, tragic backstory. My mum passed away when I was a lot younger as well.
Sorry.
And so I think, yeah, it was a really fun boys' house.
What were the initial things that you were filming and making at that time? Like, what did they look like?
Terrible. there was a couple of other young filmmakers on YouTube at that time as well. YouTube was, again, first coming around at that
time. So you were publishing on YouTube at this
time? I was publishing, yes. And there was a couple of other filmmakers, or just like people who were also like 13, 14, 15, just making sketches, doing funny things. And I went, that's really fun. So I started doing that myself. And there's a classic video of me, I think, late 14, maybe early 15 years old, dressed in a Spider-Man outfit, running around a village. And we took it seriously. I thought it was the coolest thing ever, just like running around a village dressed up as Spider-Man. And of course, there was still a couple jokes here and there, and it was definitely very immature. But again, it was just that instance of just like, I suddenly had the tools that I can make this stuff, and so I just did.
Hmm.
And I think it was just very fortunate being in that right environment for that.
What were the things that you were drawing to learn at that point? Were you like watching other YouTube videos on how to get better? And what were some of the moments where you started to realize like, hey, I'm pretty good at this. Like, I'm actually, like, this could be a thing.
I think one thing that definitely stood out to me the most was there's one YouTuber called Dominic Farah. I think he goes by, like, I think he used to go by D Fear at that time. And he made this, like, narrative prank call series where basically he was being tormented by a prank caller, and it was him trying to find a prank caller, and he ended up, like, having a fight in a forest and whatnot. And I remember when, you can do that? And I think that was the video that made me go, I want to do that. And so, and that was, I think, probably one of the first instances that made me go, absolutely, this is incredible. There was another creator called Charlie Is So Cool Like. And so like they were doing vlogging at the time. They made a video about how to make the perfect cup of tea, and that was getting hundreds of thousands, I think maybe even a million views at the time. And at that time, that was huge. And so those two were huge inspirations of, I would say, the pre-alpha generation of YouTubers, I would say. And that got me so excited about this incredible platform where you can make a video, post it, and there's an opportunity for thousands of people to see it at that time. Millions was not a concept yet, but thousands of people, hell yeah, let's go.
That's amazing. Did you, I feel like one of the biggest things I noticed with editors is there's a stage in every editor's career where they're making this decision of being just an editor or being also in front of the camera and doing other parts like producing. Obviously, you are famously known for being an editor, but now you have your own podcast, you have your own channel, you're in front of the camera. At that time, did you think of yourself as an editor or did you just think of yourself as a filmmaker creator?
I think what it was that me as a teenager, I think my social skills were probably delayed or definitely quite immature in that sense. And so me trying to be a filmmaker and definitely trying to direct people, I couldn't quite do that. But what I was able to do was probably still try to get that footage and then able to then find a ways of making it work in the editing. And I think I was able to fix all of my poor directing choices or my poor filming choices in the edit. I was able to make it all work then. And so that then became the process that I fell in love with the most. Because I'm quite an introverted person. And so if you can shut me in a room, give me footage, just leave me alone for a week, it's the best week ever. And so just that privacy, I really, really enjoy doing. And I think that's why, and I think so an introvert trying to be in an extroverted role is sometimes absolutely terrifying, even for me today. Why am I doing a podcast? Oh God, I'm shitting myself. But that's what I mean. It's just, yeah, I think it's just the introvert in me, even at that age, just editing felt like the most natural place for me to be.
I love that. And then you transitioned and went to film school.
Yeah.
What was that like?
So I went to Ravensbourne University, which is one of the first ever schools that prioritized digital filmmaking rather than filmmaking, like a physical filmmaking.
This is in London surrounding area?
Yeah, this is in London. I think it was in Greenwich in London. And I think, so I really went to that one. But I think, again, a really great testament to the time. This was 2011, 2012.
Wow.
And at that time, on my first week there, I was like, the lecturer was asking, so what do you guys want to be? Someone going, I'm going to be the next Quentin Tarantino. I'm going to be the next Christopher Nolan. Hayden, what about you? I want to be a YouTuber. I was laughed out of the room. They could not believe the concept. Like they thought it was the most pathetic thing. They were saying, oh, forget about YouTube. Vimeo's going to take over in a year. It's wow. Like they, I think, unfortunately, I wasn't quite in the right place. There was a couple of friends that did believe in that. But I think straight away, it was a terrible first impression. But since then, I think like, arrogantly, I would say out of that year that I was in, I would say I probably become one of the most successful students in that year that I studied in. And it's just because I saw the potential of YouTube even then in 2011, 2012.
It's amazing. And did you, did you learn things? I imagine you have, because of now your ability to take the things from the traditional world and bring them into YouTube. You found something a little bit more in the middle than also saying like, screw this industry and screw these more traditional filmmakers. You've kind of embraced that and then actually been able to go into digital and make sure that that works. What have you learned and retained from film school? And what have you had to unlearn from film school?
That's excellent. I would say, yeah, I think because we keep, as we said earlier, the rule book of YouTube has still being written, but there's a lot of rules now that we know work. That didn't exist then. And so what was the only thing I could do? I could study just traditional because that was the only thing I could study. And so it is sometimes like the basic concepts of like three act structure, character defining moments, music editing and things like that. And so there was a lot of stuff I still needed to learn how to be a competent filmmaker. And a lot of that was discovered by just studying modern filmmaking at that time. And I would still say, like, you do say that, yeah, like do those rules still apply in today's platform? Yes, I think they absolutely do, but modernized. Mm. And so the obvious would be, of course, like an hour and a half movie, of course, is not going to work on you. Well, I would like it to, but of course, trying to condense an hour and a half idea into maybe 10 minutes is probably, that's like the modernization of the concept.
Interesting.
And so everything that I have learned, I have to consider, okay, how does this work in today's format? How do I modernize that concept? How do I bring this classic proven idea and make sure that it is still effective in today? Now, if we start to go down that rabbit hole, we're going to be here for 4 hours.
Yeah, yeah.
You can go through that on the course. But I think it was, I learned a lot of those techniques and then modernized it. And then also, yeah, it was, the best way of putting it, it was, I would look at a Christopher Nolan movie and consider asking, how can I make this feel like it's a Casey Neistat video?
Mm.
And just mixing those two together and seeing what happens. And like those experiences were fascinating to have. And I think, and that's how I've always like pushed on. The irony in all of this is because this new industry is being developed and everyone does think they keep reinventing the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
They think they're geniuses, but it's like, well, like, no, that's existed for 100 years already.
Yep.
And here's one of my favorite examples of this, where I was talking to one creator and he was like, guys, I've just came up with this incredible thing. So I've hired like 5 people and I'm going to give them all of a week. I'm going to give them all a week and they're going to come up with a bunch of ideas and some story beats. And they're going to come up with all of these amazing stuff. And they're going to come back and they're going to pitch me all of these great ideas. And I'm going to call it a brain trust. And I went, that's a writer's room. It's.
I think that was probably Eric.
I didn't want to call him out. But yes, like, that's a writer's room. It's like, it's some of these things have already existed. And then like, there was another case where it's like, guys, I've discovered this amazing thing where like, if I have someone looking at this thing, cut to that object and cut back to them, I can feel like they're wanting that object. I mean, that's a Kuleshov effect. It's like, I love that all of these new filmmakers on YouTube are discovering all these filmmaking things, but they have existed for 100 years already.
Mm.
And so it's always great to look back and see what they have discovered and then go, how can we make this work in the today's formats?
What about the things you've unlearned?
Mm.
What do you feel like you had to be like, oh, that isn't true, and they were really driving it home?
Let me think. What's a traditional lesson I didn't think was relevant? I would say, but even though my opinion is beginning to change on this, opening credits. I think that's something, you know, like you've always got to have the opening sequence because you got to get the audience settled in, and that makes sense. If this person's paid to go to the cinema, the movie started, you want to give them the tone of the movie. This is how it's going to feel.
Yeah.
And so you bring in the sweeping shots of the city and the title credits, and maybe the character like mysteriously walking to the location when the first action sequence is going to start. That makes sense in film.
Yeah.
But on YouTube, of course, if someone starts doing that, I'm out.
Yeah.
But there is an exception to this. Most recently, Michelle Carey did an opening sequence.
And it was phenomenal. Yes. Black and white.
Yes.
Incredible music.
And what did it do? It told us, hey guys, settle down.
Yeah.
This is going to be a great video. And so,
like, get off your phone, go grab your popcorn, grab your drink, put this on the TV.
It was exactly that. It told me to put this on the television.
Yeah.
And it told me to settle down. And so I actually did love that. And so if you asked me that question 2 weeks ago, I would say, don't do opening titles. But after seeing that, it's actually proven, well, it's like we're coming back full circle again. I can imagine probably the same thing happened for filmmakers during then. Like, how can we get audiences to settle into this? Why don't we just have an extended sequence that just gives them the tone, the feeling, and let them start and welcome them into the story? That's an interesting idea. But I think it's going to have to take a few more experiments to get it right. I think Michelle just like, and that team knocked it right out of the park right away. Could that work in the Mr. Beast video? I don't think so.
Yeah.
But it could have been interesting if you tried.
Yeah. Yeah. You never really know if you don't try with these things.
Yeah.
How have you done that? Because working with, like, it's interesting, even with Eric, early on in the channel, it was like, taking risks was so much easier, trying something and being like, how does that work, so much easier. Now he continues to experiment with these various formats pulled from different shows. And sometimes things hit really well, like mm-hmm. the Bachelorette video, and sometimes things don't land in the same way. I'm so curious to learn from you where you've been able to take experiments and then how you kind of evaluate, does this feel like the right time to do it, or is this too big of a swing? Is it going to pay off, especially when you're doing it for someone else's video and now you have to convince them it's a good idea?
I think then the gamble, I would say, is probably huge. And I think most recently, probably the best anecdote to probably explore that concept would be earlier this year, I did work with Mr. Beast in making, in editing his, the 1,000 People's Blindness is Cured video.
Yep.
And when I was going through all of that footage, I realized this is a Queer Eye episode. This is something that you do watch on Netflix where the Fab Five come in and they help people lift them up and put them on a new life path.
Mm-hmm.
And I had gone through the footage at the exact same tone. And so I think I let that influence my creative choices and I would say the structure of how that video played out. But I think my mistake was I think I did play it a bit too traditionally, where I think I went a bit too far into the traditional language. This would have been a great Queer Eye episode. But then, and so that was, I think, the risk and the gamble. And then I showed that to Jimmy, and Jimmy was like, this is a really, really great video. It's not going to work on YouTube, though.
Yeah.
And so we then collaborated, and then I was then collaborated with the Mr. Beast editing team, who do know his language a lot better. And we helped trim it down to what was originally a 12-minute video, down to, if I now remember, like a 6 to 8 minute video.
Yeah.
And so, like, that was a risk, that was a gamble. And I'm really glad I took it because I made a really fantastic Queer Eye episode. And then we end up making a really fantastic YouTube video as well. But I think with Jimmy, I understand because it's like, you can't quite take as much risks as a much significantly slowed down video on his channel. And so I would say it was worth the risk, but it was worth the risk trying, but it was actually, if I'm honest, too risky to actually go through with that version.
Question, I want to use that to kind of get into, what do you think, you've seen a lot of early staged editors, a lot of people who are just entering into the field. What are some of the most common mistakes that you're seeing young editors or early stage editors make?
I think two that I think are most worth talking about is editing too fast and over editing.
Explain what that means.
So I think over editing is, and I think, and I see this a lot with like Twitter threads, like, look how great this editing thing. And it's like, the person who, hey guys, I'm going to be doing this. And like text comes behind them, flashes come, something in the corner pops up, they cut to a meme, this animation then comes up. Everything then flips side down and then something explodes and that was 2 seconds. I'm like, well, what the fuck just happened? And for me that, and then every time I see that, I always ask the question, why? And then my theory is that it's, I want to show off how great of an editor I am rather than, is this actually serving the story? And so I think one of the biggest mistakes a lot of new editors do is they prefer to show off rather than service the story.
And how do you determine how to service a story? Because that sounds good in theory, but how does one, how does one know when they're doing that and feel like there's a purpose behind the decisions that I'm making?
The best example always will be Casey Neistat. I think he was able to tell his stories with simple cuts, Helvetica font, just lo-fi hip-hop music. And we all tuned in every single day, enthralled, engaged, like, enamored, like, this is absolutely fantastic content, and he didn't over-edit. And I think, and it's, and so that is the rule. Can you tell me your story, No, can you show me your story in the most basic way first before you go into the extreme stuff?
That's really powerful. How have you been able to build empathy to the emotional journey and place that you're taking someone? And is that like a, what is like almost like your emotional palette as you're editing in order to be like, how is someone going to feel when they receive this? And is that a muscle that's developed over time? Is that something that's like you have it or you don't? How do you know when you're watching a cut and you're making it, how do you also recognize you're seeing that thing like 40 times? You kind of, I imagine to some degree, become emotionally numb to the way that that feels, or do you?
But that's the benefit. I get emotionally numb to it and I go, okay, this is not hitting me anymore. And then I, so therefore I try again or try something new. And then, so then it hits me again. And so it's the fact that I realize it's not hitting me anymore. Like that's,
and that's a bad sign.
No, that there, yeah, that's the bad sign. But then that means, great, I get to try something new.
Right.
And so I think for me in empathy, my journey in having empathy for the audience and my empathy in editing was actually just simply me learning a lot more about myself, learning a lot more about my own emotional responses, learning what is it that makes me laugh, what makes me cry, what makes it work for me. And that's a whole another like hour long discussion. And so, but like for me, my priority is I need to get me to emotionally respond to this, even though I'm already sick of this footage. And if I can make myself emotionally respond, then I've done it. And so I don't actually really think about the audience that much. I actually make these videos for me.
So almost as a creator, you are the act of the creation is consuming it as well.
Yeah.
And recognizing your own self-awareness and your own emotional awareness.
Mm.
Being a good editor means that you have to be really self-aware.
Absolutely. It makes me very insecure though as well. But yes, I think part of it was, if I'm honest, my pandemic hobby was getting the best therapist in Los Angeles. And he taught me a lot about understanding myself. And it truly, truly elevated me so much as a creative editor in understanding like emotional intelligence as well. And so I think that was what made me transcend into a new quality of editing. And so I think what I'm trying to say is like, if you do really want to be a phenomenal editor, you have to learn a lot more about yourself and also understand emotional intelligence as well.
Amazing. One thing I want to make sure we touch on, so I'm going to segue a bit because I think this is an important part. A lot of the questions I imagine you get are around, Hayden, how do I hire an editor? Where do I hire an editor? How much do I pay an editor? All things about working with editors. Now, you've become in the seat as well of hiring your own editor.
Yeah.
We've collaboratively hired an editor and worked with an editor in order to create some of the materials in the bootcamp that we're creating together and launching together. Where should one start? As soon as the idea comes to mind of, I think I want to hire an editor, what are the questions that someone should be asking themselves or the checkboxes that they should be acknowledging before they just go out and start posting on Twitter that they want an editor?
I think it is still something that I'm definitely trying to figure out a lot more myself. But I think one of the my attitude towards me learning what the best way to hire an editor is, I reflect on all of the shit moments I've had being an editor,
yeah,
and making sure that doesn't happen again. And so I was like, okay, what didn't work for me and how can I make this better for everyone else? That's been my first attitude towards this. But I think when to acknowledge when you want an editor, I think it is when the workload does get very overwhelming. When you can't quite handle making the content and getting it edited at the same time. And also when you feel like you also understand your editing language. What is it that you like in editing? And can you put that on a piece of paper or make that like a short training manual? Great. Once you've put that on paper, that's where you can probably then start hiring.
Let's pause there. What does a training manual for an editor look like?
Oh, that's a great. I think something I'm still working on, but it is like just how can you share your philosophy? What is it that you like to see in editing? So it could be instances where it's, if this happens, therefore you should do this. If this happens, therefore you should do this. If this happens, maybe then try this. If this person says this, you should try this. But if that doesn't work, you should instead then try this. Mm. And so it is the writing down your problem-solving formulas and then sharing it with them. And then because most importantly, I think we develop our own editing instinct. We know what works for us. And then I think the common mistake that a lot of people make is, oh, well, you hire an editor and like, oh, it's obvious. Like, of course they're going to not make that. Of course they're not going to make that mistake, but they do. And then you go, what the fuck was that? And they go, well, I didn't know because you didn't tell them. Mm. It's that I think understanding the what has become obvious to you is because you've done it 100 times already, whereas they haven't. They don't have the experience to know that. And so I think a lot of training actually comes into empathy. I even had that recently where we hired an editor to edit one of our podcasts. And I think, I did the classic mistake when I just sent him 2 of my favorite videos of the podcast. I went, hey, do this. And I didn't hear from him for a week. I gave him the space. He sent me the first edit. And it was terrible. It was like not even close to what I wanted. Now, I actually had a choice. I could have gone, what the fuck is this? How dare you? I'll pay you, but fuck you. But I have had that experience. But what I instead did do is, hey, I don't think I'm sorry. I failed to communicate to you what I would like this edit to be. How open-minded would you be if we sit down for 2 hours and I can show you the process? Yeah. And so it's exactly what we did. We went on a video call and I showed him the process where I took his edit and he saw me live. He saw me edit it live. And I gave him the examples of how I would like this to be. And then I was sharing my philosophies and I even discovered some of my own philosophies. Like, hey, it's interesting that I do this. How, what do you think about this? Like, yeah, that's interesting. And I went, okay, now you have a better understanding. Off you go. And then I didn't hear from him for another week. And he came back almost perfect.
Wow.
He just got it straight away. And that was, I think I still had to give him quite a few notes of just cleaning up, just a little bit of polishing. But he knocked it out of the park because I simply gave him empathy and understanding, hey, like, I need to give you guidance into how to make this work. And so just worked together into doing it. And then off he went and then gave me a fantastic video because of that.
It seems like editing is almost something that's best learned through as close to apprenticeship as possible.
Yeah.
It's like if you can get someone to look over your shoulder and you look over their shoulder, it's about the highest probability that you can get to getting to the result that you want.
Yeah. It's like they have to witness your process.
And see the decisions that you're making in real time. Sometimes those decisions are lost when you just watch finished result.
Yeah. You don't see the timeline.
Yeah.
You don't see all of the little other small touches I did to make that work.
Yeah.
And so...
Or the stuff that didn't make it,
the stuff that didn't make it, exactly. Like, and the choice is just why that was cut. It's like, it's honestly, I think another effective way for someone to learn is to just give them one of your timelines and just let them study inside of it. Literally lift up the hood of the car and see the engine. I think even that could still be incredible training for someone.
That's fascinating. There should be a place where you can like upload timelines for people to like dive in and take a look at them.
Oh man. We do Timeline Tuesdays. We upload our screenshots, but for someone to actually maybe even go through and look through that timeline, that would be incredible. That's a good idea, actually.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Maybe a little collaborative project if we don't have enough on our plate. if I'm a creator, which technically I am now, and I want to hire an editor, but my channel doesn't make enough money for me to pay them a salary. Mm-hmm. Am I shit out of luck? Or do you think that there are creative ways that people can hire editors? I mean, and we can workshop this together because obviously I have experience hiring editors for multiple channels. A lot of people don't know what to pay editors. My recommendation to a lot of channels is, well, if you can pay them a percentage of your ad revenue or a base plus your percentage of ad revenue, that can be a really good model. And that editor is now incentivized to make really good videos that get views so that they can participate in the upside of the channel. What do you think about structures like that? And have you seen any others that work when a channel is still very small?
I think I do agree in that concept. I think it's like a share on ad revenue. I think traditional calls it residuals. Again, just we're coming back to that. It's just the same thing again, reinventing the wheel.
Yeah.
I do agree in that concept a lot. But I think with my pushback on that is smaller channels don't really get that much. Big bag just yet. And so it's, if I'm honest, it feels like a bit of an empty promise, if I'm honest.
Mm.
But because like, great, residuals, it's like $1. Great. But I do agree. But what that does promise, though, is we can work together in the growth. And so that bag does go up. And so, yes, I think like I have a push-pull opinion on that, if I'm honest.
Do you think that YouTube channels in the future will continue to just hire editors internally? Or do you think that we're going to start seeing agencies pop up? And I know you've thought of making one of these at times, like, oh, people come to me for me to edit, but maybe I could just be like, look, I've vetted these editors and you can hire this agency. Do you which direction do you think YouTube will kind of go in that sense?
I think both. Mm. I think some creators just want to make content and they need that base level of quality that's acceptable enough for it to go out onto YouTube. And there will be agencies for that that will do the job. But then there are other creators that go, I actually want that artistic touch. I want that unique touch. I want that perspective. And then you hire probably more so that individual. I'm exploring both of those camps where I would say I can be probably training someone up and then maybe a creator goes, hey, I want someone with your perspective. Hey, I've trained this person up for 6 months. You can go and have him. But I think both of those industries can exist.
How do you think AI plays a role within that industry?
I think that's a really, really interesting transition that we're in our culture and in our work culture. Now, I am really excited and also very concerned about how AI is going to be doing all of this. What I am excited about with AI is it can do the busy work, the work that every editor always admits they do not want to do. Someone sends you just that A-roll, and you got to remove one of those silences. Great. Click a button. It's done. Okay, we recorded a podcast. So you've got three cameras. You're going to cut between those three. Press a button. It's done. Great. Because no one enjoys that step. I love that step is now done. And what does that mean for that editor? They don't have to do the busy work as much. And they then get more time to be creative. They get more opportunity to actually try something new. Because 2-3 days of their time have now just been vanished, and they've now got an extra couple of days to discover what they like to do. That excites me. I think the fact that a lot of AI developers seem to love the idea of going after the creative aspect, I cannot understand. But my theory always has been they've never been creative themselves, and so now they want to just take it.
And I think they also like throwing the moonshot of like where it goes.
Yeah.
And I think those things are always potentially better in story than they might be in practice. But yeah, we have seen AI be able to do some incredible things. I've heard you say this in the past, where what it's essentially doing is now raising the bar of what is mediocre.
Yes.
Like mediocre used to be down here. Mm-hmm. Now mediocre is up
here.
Yeah,
that's exactly what it is. If mediocrity is just like I've seen this before, this has happened again and again and again, and this doesn't feel new to me, that's fantastic. That's so much data for an AI to learn. And if I can then click a button and it can give me a mediocre video, cool. That's probably most people's end game. I don't agree with that, but if that's their opinion, that's I'm fine with them having an opinion. But now that what that means for me is that's a starting point for me. Great. Now I can get started in what it is that I want to do with this video sooner. That excites me. And so, yeah, mediocrity is now so much more accessible, but it's your choice on whether you take that extra step where AI cannot replicate.
Or doesn't have the data points to. Mm-hmm. It almost seems like we're in an interesting point where the more unique and novel you may make something over the next few years, the more chance you have for people to go, wait a second, I haven't seen that before. Mm-hmm. What is that? Why is it that way? Everyone else is doing it this way. And that actually gets us, our brain, to snap out of the rhythm and the routine that we're in and be like, that feels and looks very different. And so you want to pay attention to it because other than that, we're in this autopilot of everything feels the same. The cut opens with the same. Today I'm going to da-da-da-da-da-da and fast pace, whatever. The moment something introduces itself in a little bit new of a fashion, it primes our interest.
When every video gives you the exact same feeling, what does that do? That's a repeated emotion. That has diminishing returns. And so the second that you're given a brand new emotion, a brand new feeling, you go, oh, that's good. I want some more of that. And so like those, and so like the content that transcends AI mediocrity now becomes, the demand for it is now going to be even bigger now. And I think now making an AI content is going to be so much more forgettable because they all feel the same.
Yeah. I have a theory I want to run by you, and then I want to get into some clips that we have from some videos, and I want to get to see your perspective on the breakdown of some of the pillars of them. But my theory is that, you know, we've gone through multiple stages of filmmaking and cinema, let's call it. We went from you mentioned Jurassic Park in like the 1990s. That was like, holy crap, look at these effects, look at these dinosaurs. I can't believe that we've gotten to this point. And we've now, you know, gotten to a stage where we have movies like Avatar and the level of CGI that they're able to create is incredible. And because of that, we've also seen digital's introduction and the raw and the unfiltered things that people like Casey Neistat or the creators that we've now seen on short form platforms like TikTok rise to popularity as almost like this other side.
Yeah.
You're getting traditional filmmaking world creating this like really premium CGI type film. And then you see digital creators making things very raw and unfiltered. I think my theory in this is that I think AI is going to give more opportunity to independent bedroom filmmakers to incorporate levels of CGI and animation into their films, even into something like a short form film.
Yeah.
Where previously in the 1990s and early 2000s, you would have to be Pixar to create something like Toy Story. Mm-hmm. But I think AI might give the next Hayden-Hillier Smith or, you know, the bedroom filmmaker, the ability to create their own Toy Story in the comfort of their bedroom as a 60-second short.
And I fucking love that. I love that idea. Everything that you've just said, now replace the word AI with digital cameras. Yeah. It's the exact same idea. It's like digital cameras first came along, my first flip phone, that was my first digital camera. That was the first time I could ever start making videos. And off I went. There is some kid this second playing with some AI tool that's giving them the opportunity and starting them on that same life path that's going to make me obsolete in 5 years. But honestly, I love that because it means is everyone's getting the opportunity to make better content sooner. And oh my God, does this mean we're going to get so much fantastic content? Like, we're going to be spoiled for choice in theory. And I love that theory. In the exact same way when digital cameras first came around, the sheer excitement, that generation above me, that went, I wish I had a digital camera when I was younger. I was doing it with film. A film is not accessible. Steven Spielberg made a movie about it, The Fablemans, about him trying to get film. And that was like how difficult it was. It's like, I love and I am jealous and envious of what this next generation has. And it makes me so excited of what they're going to be able to be doing. And I want to be there to help guide them into like this next generation.
So beautiful. I couldn't agree with you more. It's so true that people forget that Premiere was invented in 2003.
Yeah.
So what, and it's easy to get jealous. Someone was telling me this the other day of like, oh my God, I'm so jealous of this new next generation. They're going to be able to do X, Y, Z. I was like, you know what? We still got it pretty good. We got the internet and computers. We could have had no Premiere and we would have been looking for film.
I know, exactly. So it's just, I know, it's just like the more things change, the more they stay the same. This is such a great...
It's another cycle. It keeps coming back.
It seems to be the theme of this conversation. Traditional like and modern is like, it's just the more things change, the more they stay the same. Like, it's just a cycle. And so it makes me believe if you want to be able to predict the future, look at history.
Yeah.
And I said, I'm looking at the history of digital cameras and what did that do for everyone? What is AI going to do? We cannot predict it, but goddamn am I excited.
But it's amazing. Thank you for coming on the pod. Thank you for sharing your wisdom. And we'll see a bunch of incredible editors coming out of this experience.
I really hope so. I'm really excited. Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Amazing.
Respect.